So let me start the second lecture. So at the first lecture, I talked about the nuclear reaction above the neutron threshold energy. So in this lecture, I will talk about the nuclear reaction below the neutron separation energy. So below the neutron separation energy, nuclear reaction can be obtained by the nuclear resonance fluorescence. So when the nucleus is irradiated with photons, nucleus is resonantly excited and immediately emits by emission of photons. So this process called nuclear resonance fluorescence. So nuclear resonance fluorescence takes place via only electromagnetic interaction. So the transition probability can be extracted from the measured scattering cross-section model independently. So the 1 minus, 1 plus, and 2 plus states can be selectively excited by nuclear resonance fluorescence, which enable us to study the dipole and quadrupole response. So since most of previous photon beam is not polarized, so it is difficult to determine the multipolarity of transition. So by using linearly polarized photon beam from Compton, laser Compton scattering, we can determine transition multipolarity. So photo absorption cross section can be obtained from Bright-Wigner formula of this form. So here is J0 and J is spins of ground state and resonance state. And E gamma is energy of photons. And EX is energy of resonance state. And gamma is total decay width. And gamma 0 is decay width, partial decay width to the ground state. So this shows the absorption cross-section. So the width is determined by total decay width gamma. So integrated absorption cross-section can be obtained by integrating the absorption cross-section over the energy. So the result is like this form. So this is a spin G factor. And the integrated cross-section depends on the decay width to the ground state. And scattering cross-section to the state, to a state F, can be obtained by the product of integrated absorption cross-section and the gamma F over gamma. Here the gamma F is the decay width to the ground state. Decay width to the state F. So this is a branching ratio to the decay to the F state. So the when the resonance state only decay to the ground state, which is gamma equal to gamma 0 and gamma F, the scattering cross-section become this form. So for the even nuclei, the ground state spin is 0. So if we think about the dipole excitation, the resonance state spin is 1. The spin G factor becomes 3. So we can get a scattering cross-section for dipole excitation like this form. So for quadrupole transition, the resonant state spin is 2. So the spin G factor become 5. So the scattering cross section become like this one. So decay with to the ground state can be extracted from the scattering cross section, which is obtained by the experiment. So comparison with nuclear theory can be made through the reduced transition probability, which is expressed as B. This is a multipolarity, and this is gamma energy. So relation between gamma 0 and B is obtained by the single particle model, like this form. So for even nuclear, the transition probability for E1 transition and M1 transition and E2 transition can be written into these equation. So the transition probability for dipole excitation is proportional to the inverse of the E gamma to the third power. So on the other hand, for quadrupole excitation, the transition probability is proportional to the inverse of E gamma to the power of the 5. So here the arrows, up arrows shows the excitation. And there is a relation between the transition probability for the excitation and the de-excitation through the spin G factor. So this is a angular correlation of the transition. So the angular correlation for the linearly polarized photon beam is different from the angular correlation for the unpolarized photon beam. So first I will show the case for the unpolarized photon beam. So the angular correlation for unpolarized photon beam can be expressed as this form. So using Legendre polynomials of Newth order. So here the theta is the angle between incident photon and scattered photons. The A nu 1 and A nu 2 is the expansion coefficient, which is obtained from the mixing ratio and the F coefficient. So in the following discussion, I will concentrate on the even-even case for the even-even nuclei. So for dipole transition, angular correlation can be expressed as this form. So the angular correlation for dipole transition is concentric asymmetry along the beam axis. So this shows the angular correlation in polar diagram. So for dipole transition, the strength is maximum at most forward and most backward direction, and minimum at the scattering angle of 90 degrees. So this is for quadrupole transition. The angular correlation can be expressed as like this form. The angular correlation also concentric symmetry. So polar diagram is shown in this figure. So the shape is different from the dipole case. So this difference can be used for the determination of the multiple order of transition. So for the linearly polarized photon beam, the angular correlation can be written like this form. So omega W theta is the angular correlation for unpolarized photons, which I shown. And plus minus L1, phi is angle between the electric field vector of incident photon beam and the scattering plane of the gamma ray. And plus minus L1 is plus 1 for electric and minus 1 for magnetic transition. So P nu 2 is the unnormalized associated Lagrange polynomials. So for dipole transition in EVEV nuclei, angular correlation is written like this form. So here is the angular correlation for dipole transition for the unpolarized photon beam. So the plus sign is for M1 and minus sign for E1 transition. So this shows the angular correlation of E1 and M1 transition for vertically polarized photon beam. So at the scattering angle of 90 degrees, the strength can be strength is like this shape. So the strength is maximum at phi equal to 90 degree over 270 degree, which is parallel to the polarization axis. And minimum at phi equal 0 and 180 degree. So this case is perpendicular to the polarization axis. And this case is parallel to the polarization axis. So for M1 transition, the maximum at phi equal 0 over 180 degree, and minimum at 90 degree and phi equal 90 degree and 270 degree. So the behavior is opposite for E1 transition and M1 transition. So this relation can be used for determination of the transition managed polarity, E1 or M1. So this also shows the angular correlation for quadrupole transition. So this figure shows the angular correlation for E2 transition for vertically polarized photon beam. So the strength at the scattering angle of 90 degrees is similar behavior, same as the magnetic dipole case. So this shows the principle of determination of the multipolarity of the transition. So sensitivity of the transition effect to angular correlation is maximum at scattering angle 90 degrees. So for dipole transition, the angular correlation at the scattering angle 90 degrees can be written in this form. So plus sign is for M1 and minus sign for E1. So if we take the intensity asymmetry of this form, the intensity asymmetry becomes plus 1 for M1 transition and minus 1 for U1 transition. So therefore, by measuring the energy of gamma ray scattered in parallel and perpendicular to the polarization axis, we can determine the multipolarity of the transition. So the intensity asymmetry, this one, is similar for M1 and E2 transition. So we cannot distinguish these transitions by intensity asymmetry. But the angular correlation is different for these transitions, as shown in this graph. So if we take the ratio of the angular correlation at 90 degree and 145 degree. So this ratio become 0.6 for dipole transition and 1.3 for quadrupole transition. So by measuring this ratio, we can determine the M1 and E2 whether the transition type is M1 or E2. So this is a typical setup of the nuclear resonance measurement at AIST. So the wave plate is placed after the laser system. So this wave plate is used to change the polarization axis of laser photon to vertical plane and horizontal plane. And the target is placed at the center of three germanium detectors with relative efficiency of 100, 120, and 140%, placed at the horizontal plane at the scattering angle of 90 degrees and 145 degrees. So we use a very large volume germanium detector because we measure the high energy gamma ray up to 10 MeV. So this shows the germanium detectors. Target is sitting center of these germanium detectors. So there is a collimator in front of the germanium detector to define a solid angle of scattered gamma rays. So this is also a red block, which is used for shielding the scattered gamma ray of incident photons. So this shows the photograph of the LHS beam lying at AIST. So the laser beam deflected twice here and here and injected into the storage ring. And the laser beam collided with the electron around here, and the LHS photon beam comes out into this direction. So this shows the NRF spectrum for LED 208. So we can see many peaks, but the five peaks marked with circles are associated with photo peak. And the peaks labeled S and D are due to the single and double escape peaks. So the difference between photo peak and escape peaks is 511 kV. So in addition, there is a background from Compton escape event around here. So in order to remove this background contribution, it is used to measure the scattered gamma ray by changing the energy of the incident photon beam about 500 kV. So these are spectrum taken with different photon energy. So these are taken, so this is the maximum photon energy, 7.4, 6.9, and 6.1 and 5.5 MeV. So the first spectrum is the same as the previous slide. So photo peak are shown with their energies in kV. So the second spectrum is obtained by the maximum energy of the photon less than 500 kV than the first spectrum. So the escape peaks from these peaks disappeared in the second spectrum here and here. And also we can see several peaks around 6.3 MeV, which are hardly seen in the first spectrum. So similarly, in the third spectrum, there is no peak around here. So we can conclude that these peaks are associated with the escape peaks. So this kind of measurement is essential for the nuclear resonance fluorescence measurement. So this shows the intensity asymmetry. So the left figure, the top figure, is obtained by using German detector, which is placed in parallel to the polarization axis. And the bottom figure is obtained by German detector placed perpendicular to the polarization axis. So we can see a clear difference between these spectrum. So the right figure shows the intensity asymmetry. So this asymmetry become plus 0.85 for M1 and E2 transition, and minus 0.85 for E1 transition. So data are clearly separated. So we can determine the peaks appeared here, M1 or E2, and the peaks appeared in the bottom figure is E1. So I should note that the measured asymmetry is less than unity because of the finite detector solid angle. So we cannot distinguish M1 and E2 from intensity asymmetry, but from angular correlation, we can determine this multipolarity. So this shows the intensity ratio, angular correlation ratio for these peaks. So the ratio become 0.6 for dipole transition and 1.3 for quadrupole transition. So the data are clearly separated between these numbers. So for example, these transition peaks marked with red circles have an angular correlation ratio of about 0.6. And also, peaks marked with a blue circle have an intensity ratio of 0.6. So these are dipole transition. And for this peak, around 7 MeV, this one has an intensity ratio of about 1.3. So we can determine this transition is E2. So from these measurements, we found the detailed magnetic dipole resonance in LED-208. So before our measurement, M1 strength in LED-208 is measured by off-axis Bremsstrahlung tagged photon. So Bremsstrahlung photon is partially linearly polarized at off-axis component. So from this experiment, M1 strength between 5.5 and 7.4 MeV obtained. The total M1 strength is 8.8 between these energy. So this compare the result from the tagged photon experiment and experiment using the LCS gamma beam. So the data taken with the LCS photon beam are shown with the red circles. So previously reported M1 transition reassigned some of the transition and reassigned E1 and E2 transition from the measurement with LHS photon beam. So based on the new assignment, the total M1 strength become about 6 million squares at this energy region. So this is due to the targeted photon beam is less polarized, so resulting the long assignment. So the total M1 strength from the data taken with the LHS photon beam is 11.1 million squares. So this is about twice as the data from the targeted photon beam. So this shows the typical behavior of dipole transition in nuclei as a function of the excitation energy. So I explain the giant dipole resonance and Pygmalion dipole resonance. So in addition to these electric dipole resonance, two types of resonance of the magnetic resonance appears at the lower energy. So these are called spin flip magnetic dipole mode and scissors mode. So spin flip magnetic dipole mode is due to intrinsic spin oscillation of protons and neutrons like this. Proton spin and neutron spin oscillate. And scissors mode is due to the orbital spin rotation in deformed nuclei. So as shown in this figure. So the spin flip M1 mode is produced by particle hole excitation across the major shell. So a shell model transition of L plus 1/2 to L minus 1/2, which flips the intrinsic spin, plays a major role. For example, a transition from F7/2 to F5/2 in FP shell nuclei. So by interaction between proton and neutron particle hole state, two types of intrinsic spin oscillation is generated. One is in-phase oscillation of the intrinsic spin, and the other is out-of-phase oscillation. So this is called isoscalar and isovector spin flip M1 mode. So the magnetic dipole operator can be obtained by this equation. So here is the GL and GS is orbital and spin G factors. The values are shown here. And L and S is orbital and intrinsic spins. So the magnetic dipole operator can be written using these two terms, isoscalar magnetic dipole operator and isoscalar and isovector magnetic dipole operator, like this. So this is a isoscalar magnetic dipole operator. So here is a GIS is a isoscalar orbital and spin G factors. So the proton and neutron G factor is added. So by using this representation, we can get the second equation and the by using the total spin. Total spin is equal to the sum of the orbital and spin, orbital spins and intrinsic spins. So by using this one, we can get the third equation. So substituting these spin G factors, so we can finally get the isoscalar magnetic dipole operator, like this one. So similarly, isovector magnetic dipole operator can be written by using isovector G orbital and spin G factors. So by using the isospin representation, we can get the second equation. So this is TZ equal to zero Yamaha operator. So substituting the spin G factor for proton and neutron, these numbers, we can get this expression. So the first term is the orbital part associated with the scissors mode. The second term is the spin part. So the isovector component has larger contribution to the magnetic imant, magnetic dipole strength than isoscalar component, because the large coefficient for the spin part compared to the isoscalar spin part. So this shows the comparison of M1 strengths in the different nuclei. So left figure shows the orbital and spin M1 strengths in iron 56, gadolinium 156, and uranium 238. So this is a spin magnetic dipole component, and this is orbital one. So spin strength has larger fraction for all nuclei. So the left figure shows the comparison of isoscalar and isovector M1 strengths in uranium 238 and lead 208 and samarium 154. So the uranium 238 and samarium 154 have a broader broader M1 strength than compared to the lead 208. So this is because the high level density of underlying state in uranium 238 and samarium 154, which is a well deformed nuclei. So on the other hand, lead 208 is doubly magic nucleus and spherical shape, so that the level density is low. So next I will show the application of nuclear resonance fluorescence, which is a non-destructive isotope detection of nuclear materials. So this shows the principle of this method. So when the energy of the incident photon beam is adjusted to the energy of the resonance, so this nucleus is resonantly excited and emits the gamma ray with energy identical to the incident photon beam. So each nucleus has this characteristic resonance. So by measuring this NRF gamma ray, we can identify the isotope. So in this method, we use the high energy gamma ray with energy of MeV, has a high penetrability. So this method can be applied for isotope identification of materials shielded by heavy thick metals, such as spent nuclear fuel. So there is two methods based on nuclear resonance fluorescence. One is scattering method, the other is transmission method. So in scattering method, the NRF gamma ray from the sample are directly measured by using gamma ray detector. So in this case, the intensity of the NRF gamma ray is proportional to the amount of the isotope in the sample. So in transmission method, transmitted gamma ray through the first sample are used to irradiate second target, which we call scattering target or witness plate. So witness plate consists of the isotope which we want to analyze. So by measuring the gamma ray, NR gamma ray from witness plate, we can determine the depletion of the incident photon beam due to the absorption in the first sample. So we perform the demonstration experiment of this NDA method at high energy intensity gamma source Higgs facility in Duke University. So at this facility, quasi-mono energetic photon beam with energy between 1.8 and 60 MeV can be produced from inverse Compton scattering using intracavity free electron laser photons. So this shows a measured beam, measured energy distribution of the LCS photon beam. So the width is typically a few percent. The intensity is between 10 to the 6 and 10 to the 7 photons per second. So this shows the experiment setup for scattering method. The photon beam is transported to the measurement room through the kappa collimator. So there is a lead and concrete shield between the collimator room and the measurement room. So we use uranium target placed inside the iron shield. So the uranium target has a weight of 25.8 grams. So this shows the germanium detector and the uranium target shielded by iron box. We use four germanium detectors with relative efficiency of 6% placed at the scattering angle of 90 degrees. So these germanium detectors are covered with lead sheet. And the lead and the kappa sheet is placed in the front of the germanium detector to reduce the low energy gamma ray. So this is a view from the downstream. So these are gamma germanium detector, and the target is here. So beam coming from the behind. So this is the result of the measurement. So this shows the energy spectrum of NR gamma ray from uranium target. So although the target is placed inside the thick iron, so we can see a NRF peak. So the blue line shows the measured spectrum. So we can see a peaks from uranium-238. So we also perform the Monte Carlo simulation using GIANT-4. So in the GIANT-4, there is no function to calculate nuclear resonant fluorescence. So we added this function to calculate nuclear resonant fluorescence process. So red one shows the result of the simulation. So the this will reproduce the measured spectrum. So there is also several peaks appeared in the measured spectrum due to the activity from the uranium target. So this is a measurement of transmission method. So we use plutonium-239 absorber, which has a weight of 183 grams, corresponding to 1.3 terabecquerel. So the beam is energy is 2.2 MeV, and the width is about 4%. The intensity about 10 to the 6 photons per second. So we measure the NRF gamma ray from Pluton-239 witness plate. This is the result of the measurement showing the NRF peaks from the witness plate. So we also carried out transmission measurement for aluminum 27 with various materials. So we used absorption target of aluminum, lead, concrete, and stainless. So aluminum is a simulant for plutonium-239, and lead is a simulant for uranium, and concrete and stainless is a canister simulant. So these has a thickness of several centimeters. So we measure the NRF gamma ray from the aluminum witness plate. So this is a result of the measurement showing the NRF peaks, NRF gamma ray spectrum. So this is a NRF peaks from aluminum to 27. So from this measurement, we concluded that the decrease of the aluminum NRF gamma ray intensity for the aluminum absorption target is confirmed. And small difference for concrete and canister absorption target is also confirmed. So this indicates that the measurement is affected by materials such as concrete and stainless, showing the feasibility of this NGA method. So these show the NRF data in actinide isotopes. So the resonance with integrated cross-section of 10 to 50 eV band at excited energy 2 to 4 MeV are observed for thorium-232 and uranium-235, 236, 238, and neptune-237 and plutonium-239. So the data for the thorium-232 and uranium-238 were taken with the linearly polarized photon beam at Duke University. So the multipolarity were determined, and M1 strength is shown with red lines, and E1 strength is shown with blue line. So these M1 strengths is due to the scissors mode. So for these isotopes, data are taken with Bremsstrahlung radiation. So the multipolarity is not determined for this transition. So the compilation of NRF data in EXO4 is prepared by Dr. Shimakov and Dr. Otsuka from IAEA. So this shows the table for the actinide target. So there are 7 experiments using a Bremsstrahlung photon beam, and 2 experiments which I shown the data taken with LCS photon beam. So this database is very important for the application study, such as the non-destructive isotope detection of nuclear materials. So now I show the future light source. So generation of intense photon beam were proposed in several facilities in the world. So in Japan, we propose to use energy recovery electron LINAC and laser enhancement cavity to produce intense LCS photon beam. So energy recovery LINAC reuse the electron power, and laser enhancement cavity accumulate the laser photon inside the cavity to increase the laser power. So by increasing both the electron and laser density at the collision point, so we can generate the intense LCS photon beam as much as 10 to the 13 photons per second. So this shows how to generate LCS photon beam by using electron energy recovery LINAC. So the electrons are injected into the superconducting LINAC at acceleration phase and recirculated and transported to the collision point where the laser enhancement cavity is located. The LCS photon is generated in this direction. So in this case, most of electrons do not interact with, most of electrons do not interact with photons. So these electrons are recirculated and re-injected into superconducting LINAC at deceleration phase. So the electron energy are restored inside the cavity and used for the acceleration from the injector, acceleration of electron from injector. So we performed, we demonstrated the high intense photon generation at High Energy Accelerator Research Organization, KEK. So we use compact energy recovery LINAC, which is a test accelerator. So the energy of the electron is 20 MeV. The photon, so although the photon energy is only 7 keV, so the each technical element necessary for development of the intense photon beam can be tested with this accelerator. So this shows the layout of the photon facility at compact ERL. So this is the electron gun, and this is superconducting LINAC, and there is a recirculation loop. So here is the collision point. The laser enhancement cavity is located here. The gamma ray, LCS gamma ray, is transported to the experimental room through the LCS beam line. So this shows a photograph of the equipment for LCS gamma generation. So this is an electron gun with a high voltage of 500 kilovolt. And this is a main superconducting LINAC having two cavities with 9 cells. And this is an enhancement cavity. The laser photon accumulated inside the cavity and collide with the electrons, and the LCS photon generated to this direction. So this is an experimental hatch and monitor room. So this is a LCS beam line. Since the energy of LCS photon beam is about 7 keV, so this beam line is kept in vacuum using thin beryllium foils, the end of the beam line. So we measure the LCS photon beam by silicon drop detector, which is placed in the experimental hatch. So distance between the collision point and the SDD is about 16 meters. So this shows the spot size of the electrons at the collision point. The spot size is about 30 micron. So this shows the silicon drift detector. So the active diameter is 4.66 millimeters, which is corresponding to the scattering angle of 0.15 milliradian, which corresponds to energy width of about 0.2 to 3%. So the thickness of the silicon is 500 micron, which is enough to stop the photons with energy of about 10 kb. So energy resolution is 125 to 140 mb. So this energy resolution is unfortunately larger than the expected energy width of LCS photon beam. So this is a measured energy spectrum of LCS photons. The central energy is 6.9 kb, and energy width is 173 eV. So, and the count rate is 1200 per second. So these are parameters of electrons and laser at the collision point. The electron energy is 20 MeV, and beam current is 55 microampere. And the laser wave length is about 1 micron, and the power is 10 kilowatt. The spot size of electrons and the laser is 30 micron. And the electrons, the laser, collide with the collision angle of 18 degrees. So this shows the same plot, but vertical axis is log scale. So the high energy part is the background from the Bremsstrahlung radiation from 20 MeV electrons. So we can see a very good signal to noise ratio, more than 1,000. So from the measurement of the photon flux, we estimated that the total flux generated at the collision point is 4 times 10 to the 7 photons per second. So we plan to increase the intensity of LCS photon beam by increasing the electron current and laser power. So this shows the LCS photon beam, which is used in the current photonuclear reaction measurement. The first two operated in Japan, having energy width between 5% and 10%, and the intensity is about 10 to the 6 per second. So unfortunately, the photon facility at AIST was closed after the huge earthquake March 2011. So the third one is the Higgs facility in Duke University. So this has a much better quality in energy width and the intensity. So the bottom table shows the parameter of the future light source. The first one is ELI NP is extreme light infrastructure nuclear physics facility in Romania. And second one is the second phase of Higgs facility. And the third one is the LCS facility based on energy recovery LINAC. So these photon beam are extremely high quality. The energy width is about 0.1%, and the gamma intensity is 10 to the 11 to 10 to the 13, which is fourth order, more than fourth order higher than the existing LCS photon beam. So by using this intense photon beam, so we can measure the photonuclear data for rare isotopes such as actinide nuclei and p nuclei with less amount of enriched target materials. So usually we need large amount of enriched target for photonuclear reaction. So for the less abundant nuclei, so this target is very expensive. So if we use intense photon beam, we need less amount of enriched target. So this helps us so much. So small energy width is also attractive for the precise measurement of cross-section as a function of energy with enhanced signal-to-noise ratio. So these are list of the P nuclei. So among of these, the lanthanum-138 and tantalum-180 is a special interest for astronuclear physics, nuclear astrophysics. So the tantalum-180 target enriched to about 5%, including 6.7 milligram tantalum-180 was used in the photoactivation experiment. So this is the largest amount of tantalum-180 so far used in the measurement. So although the most of composition is tantalum-181 in this sample, but the photoneutron cross-section near the neutron separation energy can be measured because the separation neutron separation energy of the tantalum-180 is 1 MeV smaller than the tantalum-181. So we can measure the photoneutron cross-section near the neutron threshold neutron separation energy of tantalum-180. So similarly, the cross-section of lanthanum-138 can be measured between these threshold energy. So these are limited information, but astrophysically very important. So we can also measure the photonuclear cross-section for many other nuclei with intense photon beam, which are important for nuclear physics, nuclear astrophysics, as well as the applications such as non-destructive isotope detection of material. So I hope that the new photon facility will open up the new possibility of photonuclear science and technology. So that's all I have. So thank you.
Okay, thank you.